Welcome to Live Free Live. We are going to have a dynamic service today. We're going to have a pre-recorded worship service coming up here very soon. Our pastor and our first lady, Pastor Terrell Taylor and Tara Taylor, are taking a break this week, a very much needed break. And so our blessings are with them. Pastor and First Lady, if you are watching, praise the Lord. We hope that you are getting the rest that you most definitely deserves. So at this time, let's enjoy a few songs of worship, and then we got a dynamic service planned for you. Stay tuned.
Ever know, you are our Heavenly Father, and we love you, and we bless you, and we praise you. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are, it's who you are, it's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. Come on, let's just give him a moment of worship. It's who you are, and I'm loved. It's who I am, it's who I am, it's who I am. And because of you, Father, I know who I am. Because you're a good, good Father. I am yours. I said, are you blessed this morning?
Thank you.
verse with me, please. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations in your family, in your children, and their children, and their children. May his presence go before you and behind you and beside you, all around you and within you. He is with you. He is with you in the morning, in the evening, in your coming, in your going, in your weeping, in rejoicing. He is for you, 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 he is for you. My heart will sing.
Still in your hands, this is my confidence. You've never failed me yet. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, faithfulness. I'm still in your hands, this is my confidence. You've never failed me yet.
We love you because you never failed us. We got close to death. Close to defeat. We may have been even thrown in the fire, but you were the fourth man inside our fire. You never failed. We love you today, God. We bless you. We honor you. We lift you up in this place. We're so grateful for who you are, for what you have been to us. We thank you for your blessing being upon our children. Children's children. We thank you, God. We love you. And as we come this morning, we empty ourselves. We empty our hearts. We empty our will. We give it all to you. There's a nevertheless deep down inside of us. Despite of what's going on, we say nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. Forgive us of all of our sins, O God. Thoughts, our words, and actions. We're not perfect, but we are striving with everything deep down inside to be pleasing unto you. We love you today. We bless you. Bless our service on today, oh God. Bless every word that will be spoken. We thank you for the songs that were sung. We thank you for every word that will be spoken. This preach word today. Bless your service on today. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you, family of God. I'm here to lead you into our communion on this morning. This is a happy communion. This is a happy occasion. It's not a sad occasion. We don't have to get depressed when we talk about the death, burial, and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. This is a happy time. Amen. It's a time of remembering what Jesus has done for you and me. And I want to talk about the power in the blood of Jesus. The power that's in the blood of Jesus. I want to specifically talk about three benefits of applying the blood of Jesus over your life. You know, we talk about the Holy Spirit a lot. We talk about the Word. But we really understand the power that's in the blood. And once we understand that power in the blood of Jesus, oh my God, we can become invincible for the kingdom of God. Yes, because I can say that word, invincible. You know why? Because Jesus said, I give you power over all the power. Not some of the power, not a few of the power, no, over all the power of the enemy, and nothing by no means can harm you. Do you believe you can be invincible for Christ today? I mean, can you be invincible for Christ Jesus? The first benefit of applying the blood is that the blood of Jesus heals. The blood of Jesus heals. Isaiah 53, 3 through 5 says, he is despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief, and we hid it as our faces from him. He was despised and we esteemed him not. Jesus went through it. So what makes you think you're not going to go through it? Surely he bore our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God and afflicted. But here we go, verse 7. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. When that blood gushed out of his body, healing took place. Are you suffering from a broken heart? a broken relationship, broken dreams? Does worry have you up at night? Are you confused? Is fear taking over your mind? Well, Jesus' blood can heal you. Are you suffering from a physical affliction? It doesn't matter what you need to be healed of. If you apply the blood, hallelujah. Somebody needs to say, I plead the blood over my family. I plead the blood over my children. I plead the blood over this marriage. I plead the blood over my mind. I plead the blood over my body. Take authority. Take back your body. Take back your children. Take back every relationship that is broken. Take back your own heart. Plead the blood. The second benefit of the power of the blood of Jesus is that the blood of Jesus cleanses. Yes. The blood of Jesus cleanses. 1 John 1:6-10. I'm just going to read the first two verses. If we say that we have fellowship with him and we walk in darkness, because you can't have real fellowship with God and like darkness, we lie and do not the truth. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship one with another. You know, we can get along better if we are in the light, if we are in his light. And the blood of Jesus Christ, his son, cleanses us from all sin. Is there a sin stain in your life? A stain that is hard to remove in your own strength. Maybe a habit that seems too hard to break. Maybe there's an addiction to something that you just can't seem to shake. Something you can't overcome. Whatever that it is, the blood of Jesus can cleanse it. Hallelujah. Say to it, I plead the blood. I don't know what your it is, because we all got a it. Oh, we all got something horrifying that's trying to lurk in us. We all got something in us that's trying to pull us away. But the blood of Jesus will keep us in line. Come on here. It's almost like a vicious dog. You got a leash. You got him tied up in the backyard. You know he's vicious, so you gotta tame him. You gotta, when he run out to go get somebody, if you got that leash on him, what it's gonna do? Jerk him back. That's what the blood of Jesus does. Hallelujah. It may not prevent temptation. It may not stop the thing that's haunting you. But if you plead the blood, come on here. If you plead the blood over that thing, it will jerk you back to righteousness. Put the blood on it. Finally, the blood of Jesus protects. The blood of Jesus protects. I'm going to read verses 12 and 13 in the book of Exodus chapter 12, but you know the story when they were dealing with the 12 plagues. And God told them in verse 3 to get your whole family, get a lamb that was without spot or blemish. I want you to kill that lamb and put the blood over the doorposts. Put the blood over the lintels of your homes. Verse 12 says, and on that same night, he said to them, I will pass through Egypt and strike down every firstborn, both people and animals. And I will bring judgment on all the gods of Egypt, and I am the Lord. Can I just throw a little something in there that God will judge? God will judge. We're looking at what's happening in the world today, and we don't want to tell the truth, but God will judge. Verse 13 says, the blood will be a sign for you on the house where you are. And when I see the blood, when I see the blood, I will pass over you. No destructive plague will touch you when I strike Egypt. Have you ever escaped something that you should have died in? Have you ever came through something that should have killed you? You know why you made it? The blood. Hallelujah. You're in something right now. You know what you need to do? Apply the blood. apply that blood. Jesus, we thank you for your shed blood. We don't take it for granted, the blood that was shed for the remission of our sins. Our communion scripture is going to come from 1 Corinthians, the 11th chapter, verse 23 through 26. And whatever you have at home that's available to get you through this communion, get something that represents the body, get something that represents the blood, and we're going to walk in the power of the blood. Verse 23 says, "For I received from the Lord what I also passed unto you." The Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, he took some bread. And when he had given thanks, because it wasn't nothing to be sad about, because we about to be delivered, we about to be set free, we about to come out, we about to be delivered from the grip of Satan. So he gave thanks, he broke it, and he said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Amen. And in the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat and of this bread and drink of this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death." Amen. God bless you today. Remember, there is power in the blood of Jesus. Happy communion. God bless.
Grateful that you chose to join us this morning. We're so grateful that you're a part of this family, whether you are from near or from far. We bless you. We thank you for celebrating together with us as the body of Christ. So welcome to church, wherever church is these days. Welcome. So we're so grateful to be here. I want to talk to you today about offering, tithes and offering, right? So we have a confession here. If you've been, you know, with us for any length of time, you know that we do a confession and we speak over our tithes and offering. But one of the things I just wanted to talk about is what is a confession? So a confession is really telling the truth, right? So you're speaking the truth. So the confession is not just something to memorize and regurgitate, but it's a confession over your life. You're telling the truth. You're speaking the truth over your life in the area of your finances, right? So, and one of the things that you have to remember, like, you know the truth. You know, when you know the truth, it'll make you free. So you start thinking about that bondage that can be over your finances. When you know the truth and you speak the truth, it will make you free. I'm a living testimony of that. So what are you speaking? What is the truth? So sometimes it takes a little bit for our minds to catch up with what our spirit already knows. So let's go over it and let's talk about it. What is that truth that we're supposed to be speaking? Because if we're sons and daughters of a king and we're declaring something over our lives, we need to know what that means. So let's go with the first one, right? We're changing it up a little bit, right? So it's, God is my source of all blessing in heaven and earth. God's will is that I am blessed beyond all measure and beyond my expectations. So now, what does that mean? That means God is our source, not our job. Listen, we need our jobs. We need our, you know, bosses to keep calling us back in for the next day of work. You know, for some of us, we're on unemployment right now because our jobs have closed or things have changed, you know. But the truth is, that wasn't our source in the first place. It's God who is our source. He is the one who blesses us. He is the one who pours it out beyond our expectations, beyond what we could imagine or think. He is the one. So that's important to shift our mindset from thinking that our job is our source and getting stressed out when we haven't gotten the call or we sent out 150 resumes and nobody's called you for an interview. It doesn't matter because God is our source. Now, we have to do our part, right? But God is our source. So we can't get depressed based off of our situation because God doesn't change. His love for us does not change. So remember, he is our source. Let's go on to the next one. He is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all we are able to ask or think. So again, we got to remind ourselves, this is what he is able to do. This is what he will do. Now, these are his promises. This is what God is saying. So now, what's our part? Right? So that's the next part. Giving is an act of what? Giving is an act of my faith. So guess what? I have to take action. He's already said it. He's already declared it. He already promised it. So now it's my part. This is what I have to do. I have to give as an act of my faith. Not just give it, but give it what? Cheerfully. Cheerfully. We're giving back to God. I mean, he gave us 100%. He said, all you have to do is give me 10. That's it. You can keep the other 90, right? So now I think about it like when I'm looking at my children, like I buy them some ice cream and I give them a gallon of ice cream and I say, can I get a scoop? And they look at me like I'm crazy. We're going to have problems. My children are not like that though. But I'm like, think about it, right? So what's your attitude? What's your attitude? If we look at our children or somebody that we've given something to and we just say, hey, can I have a small piece? And they look at you like you're crazy. You're wondering, wait a minute, but I just poured out on you. I just blessed you. You know, and if we as human beings can look at the attitude of somebody else, how much more our Father who created us, our King of Kings and Lord of Lords that says, all I want you to do is give it cheerfully, not begrudgingly, not with, you know, this, ugh, I have to do this. No, cheerfully, guess what I get to do? I have the finances to be able to give back to God what he has given me cheerfully. All right, so then now, let's go. As I trust God, right? Again, this is our part. As I trust God with what? My tithes and offerings, right? I trust that God will bless the work of my hands. So again, it's our trust, our faith in action, and we're trusting him to bless what? The work of our hands. So faith without works is dead. Faith without works is dead. You got to put an action plan together. It's not just enough to know. You got to put an action plan together and step out in it. You've got to trust him. You've got to make the action steps. Don't just say it, show it. When somebody tells me that they love me and they're showing me something different, it's kind of hard to believe. So your actions have to line up with your words. That's called integrity. So again, actions need to line up with your words. So if you receive that, I just want you to fill out your offerings, you know, with faith and with trust and not expecting something that's going to be, you know, if he doesn't do it like this, then I'm not going to ever give again. No. because God will bless you in so many different ways that you can't even imagine. He will stop the enemy. He will rebuke the devourer. He will keep your car running when you know it's 20 years old and you know it should be in the shop. You know it should be in the junkyard. He will keep it running. He will bless your marriage. He will bless your children. He'll bless your body. He'll bless your finances. So many different ways that God will bless you. All right? So let's trust him today. There are 5 ways to give. Go ahead and fill out those bill pays, a Cash App, you know, all that stuff. You know it. You see it on your screen. Do it. Do it in faith. Let's listen to this music as we worship God with our giving. Amen.
God bless you. God bless you. We are here for your announcements for this morning. I just want to thank all of the men that participated yesterday on our Strong Life 7:30 a.m. Power Packed Fellowship. Pastor Lou, amen, brought the word to us, and we thank God for him and all of the men that participated. We appreciate you for getting up and spending time in God's word with us. Also, I want to thank all of the long lifers. This past Tuesday, we continued on our Fruit of the Spirit study. And I tell you what, Brother Fitzroy can do more than work the camera. Amen. 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 He can do more than work the camera. Amen. He has a word inside of him. Yeah. And we thank God for explaining peace to us. And Brother Grady came along and hit us with that long suffering. Wow. I never knew I was just off track with patience. When Brother Grady came with that word, I had to get myself together. Come on here. Amen. And next time we come up, we're going to have Mother Carmen and Brother Gus. So we just excited, man. We having a great time with our long lifers. Y'all just don't know. We having a party on the Zoom calls. Amen. God bless. My wife going to do the remainder of these announcements. How you doing today? Hold on. How you doing today?
I'm great.
See, they didn't hear you, so I had to do it again. How you doing today?
I'm great.
All right, let me quit acting silly.
Amen. 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 Good morning. These are announcements for September the 6th. Amen. First, before we do our announcements, we just want you to know that many of our announcements are also featured on our GroupMe app. If you are not on GroupMe, please email us at info@livefreechurch.org. And let us know you would like to be added. Amen. There is no Live Free Kids tonight, this evening. Amen. So spend that special time with your children. Amen. But we thank Pastor Cheryl for always being so faithful and loving on the little ones. Amen. She is so awesome in that ministry. Amen. Fasting and prayer. Amen. Yes, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Every Monday and Wednesday in September, we are encouraging everyone to fast from something until 4 p.m. This is a season where we believe as the body of Christ, we need to rise up. Yes, Lord. And pray and seek God's face. Amen. Amen. Prayer via Zoom on Tuesday, September the 8th and Thursday, September the 10th at 7 a.m. And we are still in our studies. Amen. In the book of Proverbs. Amen. So we do invite you to come and join in every Tuesday and Thursday morning at 7 a.m. Amen. And join in with us. Amen. On our book of our study, the book of Proverbs. Amen. Our connect groups. Yes, our connect groups, as you know, are now back in session. Yeah. Amen. And we are doing them via Zoom. Amen. So on Wednesday, September the 9th at 7 p.m., we will resume with our Zoom calls for our connect groups. Amen. Our men's group. Amen. They are studying the book of Philippians with Brother Grady Coleman. And the women's group, amen, we are still studying in the book of Hebrews. God is really, amen, he's really ingraining faith in us, amen.
And that's with Pastor Laura Wilson, Lauren Hines, and myself. Amen. And amen. This Wednesday, I will be teaching this Wednesday in the women's session. Amen. Of the book of Hebrews. I'm excited. Amen. We've been really just strengthening and just encouraging one another. Amen. In faith. Amen. Amen. And now we have a grand announcement. Yes. Our 7-year church anniversary. Hey, that's awesome. Amen. Yes, yes, yes. 7 years, spiritual perfection. Amen. And as we know, the number 7 in biblical terms means completion. Amen. On the 7th day, God said, my work is completed and it is good. Amen. So we just believe God, amen, for some fantastic things in our 7th church anniversary year. Amen. Amen. We know that this invisible enemy is still present, amen, but it's not stopping God's work, amen. God's work is like a locomotive train. I tell you what, you can jump in front of it if you want to. Yeah, 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 yeah. Amen. But our 7th year anniversary, amen, we are celebrating next Sunday, September the 13th. So please tune in online at 10:30 a.m. and we will be celebrating 7 years of God's goodness. Amen. And I'm gonna tell you what. Amen. If any ministry is still surviving through all of this and throughout this time, because it's difficult these times, amen, amen, God is in the midst, amen. So we are blessed people. This is something to celebrate, people of God. Come on now. Come on here. Yes, yes, yes. Amen. Women's real life. Yes, the women. Saturday, September the 19th at 10 a.m. via Zoom, Mercedes Garcia will come to bless us. She will be ministering to the women. Amen. And she always blesses me with her, how she just goes in and, you know, she speaks in Spanish, but her daughter interprets. But I'm telling you, it is so awesome, the words that God give her. She really impacts the women. Amen. So we thank God for Sister Mercedes. Amen. And we encourage her to keep doing what she does. Amen. And lastly, subscribe to our YouTube channel. We are Live Free Church, GA, on YouTube. Amen. Amen. And also like us on Facebook at Live Free Church. And these are our announcements. Amen.
We serve an awesome, mighty God, and he is the same God time after time. He does not change. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. From the beginning to the end, he yet remains the same. The same God time after time. I just preached the whole message right there. Praise God. I could close now because that's all that I have to say. But I'm going to give you a little bit more from his word and what God is really speaking to us. So let's look to the Lord before we begin this morning. Father, we thank you for the blessing, God, of this day. We pray, God, that you would move mightily in our midst. Lord, that you would speak to our hearts. Lord, that you would let us know that you are with us, oh God. Lord, that you have a plan for us. There's so much that you have in store and so much that you have planned to do. And God, we pray, Lord, that you would help us to make ourselves available to your plan, to your purpose, God. Have your way in this service right now, Lord. We pray, God, that you would move, that your word would speak to our hearts, Lord, that we would receive everything that you have to say to us, oh God. And we thank you, Lord. Thank you for you, God, being the same time after time. We give your name glory, God, in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, church, I'm grateful this morning to be able to share this message with you because God is trying to tell us something. And when the Lord is trying to tell you something, you've really got to incline your ear to hear what he has to say. And so as I'm in my time of seeking after him and inclining my ear to hear, Lord, what do you have to say? He began dealing with me about time. So today we're going to explore time. We're taking a little exploration today. See, time is an interesting construct. We use it to define so much of our very existence. We define things by using the terms of time. For example, like your age, right? You meet someone, you introduce yourself, you know, you say, oh, this is my name. And then the next thing that you want to ask is, oh, how old are you? We don't actually ask it, though, right? You don't do that, right? We just make assumptions based on it, right? We're like, oh, how are you doing? Good. Yeah. They're about 5. They're about 10. You know, we make assumptions about what that age is. We even talk about, you know, how people may look. Like, for example, for me, you're looking at me today and you say, well, you don't look too good for 25. Right? He had a rough life. Don't look so good for 25. But then, you can take it in another direction and you can say, man, he looks great for 97. Man, that guy looked good. You know. But we define these things with time. We use time as parameters on how we interpret this life. We have different terminologies that we use that define things in our living, and many of them, when you really research it, are built around time. For example, you might say, you know, when did this happen? It's a time definition. That's from prehistoric time. That's from the Bronze Age. That started in the Middle Ages. Oh, this is the modern era that we are in. Or even more simply, we might define things like in terms of our decades, right? Oh, we've had the roaring 20s. The 80s. The 80s, you don't even need an adjective for the 80s, right? You just say the 80s and everybody knows, oh, the 80s. Yeah, we know about the 80s. And we define these things through time. Even in its most simplest form, when we break it down even further, we define things like daytime and nighttime. Right? We define our day by time. So you might be defining your time right now. You might be saying to yourself, how long is he going to talk about time? It's about time for me to get something to eat. So I need you to go ahead and wrap that up, Pastor Lou. I got things to do. But I really need you to gain the understanding of how time plays such a role in our lives. So today, we're going to talk more about this. Sometimes we go through things and we feel like, man, you know, this particular thing that I was doing was a waste of my time. You might feel sometimes like you're dealing with someone or in relationship, conversation, talking with them, and you're thinking, man, this is wasting my time. This is not worth my time. Hopefully you don't feel that way this morning as I'm talking to you, but I'm hopeful that you don't have too many of those occasions. But we say these things like, this is a waste of my time, or I can't believe how much time that took. We say those things like we have ownership over our time, right? Like I own time. Time is mine. Don't waste my time because this is my time. I own this. Now, we know that we can't stop time or start time. Well, hopefully you know that, right? It's not a Marvel movie where you have some superpower and you can just freeze time here and then restart it when you're ready. Right? It doesn't work that way. So we can't start or stop time, but we certainly do spend time. So that shows that there is some control that we have in how we utilize the time that we've been given. So we do have some controls there. So even though we can't start it or stop it, we do get to choose what happens in it. Okay, that's a reflection of what you do with it. Okay, so there are some controls that we have in time. However, I want you to know this morning. Our God is not bound by time. Time is bound by our God. I'm going to say it again for you. It's on your screen. God is not bound by time. Time is bound by God. And now, if you really understood that, you'd be in your living room jumping up and down and going crazy right now. Because that is so powerful for you in your life. When I use the word bound here, I'm using it in this context. I'm referring to bound as setting boundaries, right? Setting limitations. When I say bound by, I'm really saying limited by, okay? Pastor Chad and Minister Jelana, they did a play here, a few times here, and it's called Bound by Bitterness. And the lead character in that, he was, you know, limited by his unforgiveness. Could not move forward into all that God had for him because he was bound by bitterness. His unforgiveness was limiting where he could go. So sometimes we feel bound by time itself. You know, we feel like time has passed us by. I can't accomplish this because it's too late. I can't do that because there's not enough time for that. We feel bound by time. But I want to encourage you today that you serve a limitless God. You cannot be bound by time if you serve the limitless God. See, I explained it to you before, but I'll do it again. I'll do it again, just for you. You can't start time or stop time. But what you do in time is a choice. And so even though sometimes, because we're operating in time, you might feel like time is up or it's too late. And all of these other things that you do to define yourself with time. But the important thing that you have to remember is that you serve the limitless God. So the limitations that you see inside of time, those are not limitations of your God. Time cannot limit his plans. Do you understand that? Time cannot limit God's plan. When you think time is up, God said, I'm just getting started. You know, it makes me think about when Jesus showed up, right? Lazarus died. They came and told him Lazarus is sick. And Jesus is like, oh, I'm so sorry about that. Let's continue on ministering to these people. And the disciples are like, Lord, we got to go. That's your friend, right? We got to go. We got to go. Jesus is like, it's okay. He's asleep. And so they go and they get there and hear Mary and Martha, they're weeping and they're crying. And they're like, Lord, if only you would have come sooner. You did not arrive in time. And Jesus says, it's okay. Where's the body? Because he's not operating in time. I cannot be limited by time, Mary and Martha. My operation, my plan, my purposes are not bound by time. Listen, I'm going to break it down for you, okay? So I'm not going to read all of these verses. I'm going to say them, and you can write them down and go investigate them for yourself, all right? Listen now. Genesis 1 and 1. In the beginning, God created heaven and earth. Did you catch that? When did he create heaven and earth? In the beginning. Everything starts with my God. He spoke time into existence. Heaven and earth were created because he spoke it, and then it began. It doesn't begin until my God says so. John 1, verse 1. In the beginning was the Word. I love it. Did you catch that? Genesis 1 and 1, the Bible begins with in the beginning. In the beginning, what? God. John 1 and 1. In the beginning was the word. Now, we know what the word is. God's word is truth. God's word is his promise. God's word must come to pass. God's word was in the beginning, was with God, was God. We know that this word is Jesus because it goes on to say that the word was made flesh, dwelt among us. Amen. Praise God. And all of that was in the beginning. Psalm 102, verse 25, it says, in the beginning, he laid the foundations of heaven and earth with his hands. In the beginning, the foundations of time began with when he spoke it into his hands. Job chapter 12, verse 10, it says, in his hands is the life of all creatures and all mankind. He spoke it into existence, time began, and he holds man's existence in his hands. It says all creatures. That means you're in his hands. So is your dog and so is your cat. Your giraffe is in his hands. He spoke it all into existence. When? In the beginning. From the very beginning. 2 Timothy 1:9 says, he saved us by grace through Christ before the beginning of time. Are you catching this? Before time began, God already had a plan to redeem you. How long did he know that I would be redeemed? Before the beginning of time. Paul says in Titus chapter 1, Paul says, God planned an eternal life with us. When did he plan it? Before the beginning of time. I hope you're writing these down because I want you to go check. Go check me, check me, check me, check me. Before the beginning of time, God had a plan for your eternity. What I'm trying to get you to see is he can't be limited by time. He's the creator of time. Look, 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 look. Revelation chapter 1, verse 8 says, he is the God who is, who was, and who is to come. The Lord God Almighty. Yes, he is. He's laid it out for you. You cannot define God in the context of using time. Because he was, he is, and he is to come. Time cannot contain him. Revelation 22, verse 13 says, I am Alpha and Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. God has wrapped around your time constraints. You want to limit what God has planned for you and what he's spoken over you and what he's promised you because of time? Because it feels like it's too late? No, 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 no. He does not operate on our time. He was, he is, and he is to come. The first and the last, the beginning and the end. So I don't know if you caught that in all those verses. Hopefully you wrote them down, but we just went from Genesis to Revelation. We just did the whole Bible right there. And it has all proven that he is the God over time. He's the God over time. He's not under time. He's not in time. because time cannot contain him. He made it. It can't contain who he is. See, sometimes we think about situations like the Mary and Martha situation. God couldn't show up in time. Lord, you're too late. You didn't get here in time. He can't. God cannot show up in time. God shows up on time because he rules over it. He can't be in it. He made it. He rules over it. So when the enemy tells you that it's too late and you can't do what God promised you, you need to remind the enemy of who created the time that it seems like has run out. He cannot be contained by it. He's the creator of it. My youth pastor, when I was a teenager, he used to say this, and man, it stuck with me all these years. Yes, I know this is coming as a shock, but I'm not a teenager anymore. No, no, I was once, but I'm not now. But my youth pastor used to tell us, if he is Alpha and Omega, how can you not have time for the maker and creator of time? Did you get that? If he's Alpha and Omega, how can you not have time for the maker and creator of time? If he's the author and the finisher, then how can we say, Lord, you know, I would pray more, Lord, but I don't have time. Lord, I would be taking part in fasting and doing what Sister Carlitha told us we're doing on Monday and Wednesday, but I just don't have time. I would be watching Pastor Lou online right now, but you know it's Sunday morning and I just ain't got the time. How can you not have time for the maker and creator of time? See, put it in context so we can understand today, right? If I had hundreds of thousands of cases of water bottles, I was surrounded by cases of water bottles, and you were thirsty and parched and dry, would you walk past me and say, I would come and ask, but I don't have any water? Right? Did you catch that? That didn't make sense, right? Like, I don't understand what he just said. Yeah, I know. I don't understand it either. You are dry, parched, and thirsty, and the source of what you need is there, and you say, oh, but I don't have any. That's you telling God that you don't have time. It does not make sense. He's the author and creator of time. He has given you the time that you have. How can we not have time? How can we not make time in our day for him? Joel 2:25 says, I will repay you for the years the locusts have eaten. I love that. Because see, sometimes we feel like the things that I have done prohibit me or limit me from things happening right now because I did not properly use the previous time. If I had done this and that and I sought the Lord and I had lived righteous and holy and I had done the things that God commanded me back then I would be able to do this and this and this now. So I'm limited by what I failed to do or what my failures were in the past. But here's what God has to say about that. You are limiting your today and what he has planned for you on tomorrow because of what happened on yesterday. Allow me to explain. The limitations that you are placing on what happens now is based on your failures of yesterday. Now let me take you to what he wants to tell you today. It's found in Joel chapter 2, verse 25. I will repay you for the years the locusts have eaten. The years that have been wasted, the years that people tried to steal from you, the years when people took advantage of you, the years when things did not go according to plan. You thought those years were wasted, but God says, I will repay you for the years that the locust thought that it had stolen away. He says, I will repay you. So what he's telling you is, he is the redeemer of time. No matter what you feel is lost to time, I came with good news today. It's not too late. And time was not wasted. Because the redeemer and creator of time says that he will repay you. It's not too late. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Look with me now. I want to show you in Scripture how God shows that time does not limit him. We're going to go through these verses in the book of Joshua. This is Joshua chapter 1, verses 1 through 9. Let's look at the first two verses. Joshua 1. Verse 1, after the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord said to Joshua, son of Nun, Moses' aide, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now then, you and all these people, get ready to cross the Jordan River into the land I am about to give to them, to the Israelites. This is exciting. We're about to cross the Jordan. Let me give you some context behind what's happening here, okay? First off, Moses has passed away. Sometimes in our thinking and in our study, like I had for many, many, many years, believe that young Joshua comes on the scene and he takes leadership of Israel because Moses, the old guy, has passed away. And that's the vision that I had of this. But that's not what happened. That's not what's going on here. First off, Moses, as leader, leading God's people out of Egypt. You should know Joshua was born back in Egypt. Okay? Secondly, your leader has passed. So there is tragedy. There is perhaps confusion going on. There is that feeling of what do we do now? Or where do we go from here? Or time's up. The second thing I want you to understand is this ain't young Joshua. That's just not the case. Now, Joshua, because he was born in Egypt, he was on the journey that was happening out in the wilderness. And we're going to talk more about that in just a moment. But I want you to understand that it's not young Joshua anymore. He's been on this journey. Okay, so in the midst of all this, there's all kinds of thoughts and reactions that Joshua has to be going through. The other thought he's having is, God is saying, I'm about to bring you into the promise. So in the midst of tragedy, he also sees victory. I'm about to go into the promise, but before I can get to the promise, I've got to get across this river. So there is a body of water between where I am and where God has promised. In other words, there's a divide between where I am and what he has for me. Look with me. Let's go. Verse 3. I will give you every place where you set your foot, as I promised Moses. Your territory will extend from the desert of Lebanon and from the great river, the Euphrates, all the Hittite country to the Mediterranean Sea in the west. God reminds Joshua of what his promises were to his people. He'd already made these promises. This was not a new promise. He was reminding Joshua that I did not forget what I told you. I did not forget what I promised you, because I am the God who was, is, and is to come, the Lord God Almighty. I've not forgotten, Joshua. I want to remind you. Joshua's like, wow, this is a vast region. What a major territory. Sometimes we think the promises are too big for us. That is too major for little old me to accomplish. And we begin to set limitations on ourselves. I don't know if I'm going to be able to do that, Lord. That's a pretty vast region. Look on, verse 5. No one will be able to stand against you all the days of your life. As I was with Moses, so I will be with you. I will never leave you nor forsake you. Be strong and courageous, because you will lead these people to inherit the land that I swore to their ancestors to give them. God says, I am with you. I'm not leaving you. I'm not forsaking you. Be strong and be courageous. See, now it's getting clear that what God promised in verses 3 and 4 is going to require you to have some strength and some courage. This may be something that I don't know if I can do. And God recognizes that. And so he says, I need you to be strong, and I need you to pick up some courage. See, fear and doubt, when they heard that God was taking you on a journey, fear and doubt went in there, and they started packing their bags. Let me get my, oh, that's my favorite shirt. I got to bring that too. Come on. Where are we going? Fear, doubt, pack their bags. They said, hey, Lou, where are we going? Because we're coming with you. But what you need to do is look fear, doubt, and anxiety in the eyes and tell them, I'm so glad you packed, because it's time for you to get stepping, because I'm picking up some strength and some courage. And I'm going to walk in the promises of God. Fear and doubt are limitations that are trying to block you from what God has already promised you. When did he promise it to you? Now, I don't know when you became aware of what his promise is, but when did he promise? Before the beginning of time. He had a plan for you before time even began. You cannot fathom how much he loves you, because he made plans for you before time itself. So we see here that something great is about to happen. So let's look at what verse 7 says now. Now remember, in verse 6, the Lord told Joshua to be strong and be courageous. Take strength and take courage with you. Tell fear and anxiety to get moving. But tell strength and tell courage, come on, I'm glad y'all are here. You don't even bother packing. Just come on with me. We're going. Verse 7 picks up with, second time, be strong and very courageous. I don't know if you catch this or not, but when the Lord tells you something more than once, it might be important. You might need to know that. right? So here he comes again in verse 7 and says, be strong and very courageous. Be careful to obey all the law my servant Moses gave you. Do not turn from it to the right or to the left, that you may be successful wherever you go. Verse 8, my favorite portion of scripture. This is my favorite verse right here. Keep this book of the law always on your lips. Meditate on it day and night so that you may be careful to do everything written in it. Then you will be prosperous and successful. Thank you, Jesus. Verse 9, have I not commanded you to do what? Be strong and courageous. That's time 3. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged. For the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. Don't take fear. Don't take doubt. Don't take anxiety. Take some strength and some courage. Because your God is with you wherever you go. Thank you, Lord. See, God gives us a roadmap to success in verse 8. We've got to keep his word, keep his promises ever on our heart, our mind, our lips. Don't forget what he has said. Continue to remind yourself. You've got to remind yourself. In the beginning of this, God said to Joshua, he had to remind him, I'm going to give you this land on the west side of the Jordan. I know that Moses is gone, but on the west side of the Jordan, I've got great promise for you. He had to remind him, I promised this to your ancestors. You know, Joshua, how you guys talk about, oh, Abraham, our father, and he's the God of Abraham and of Isaac and of Jacob. He's saying, guess what, Joshua? I promised it back then to them. And now I'm about to bring it to pass through you. Joshua's like, whoa. And he said, verse 8, here's the roadmap to success. Don't let these just be words that come out of your mouth. You need to meditate on it day and night. My promises are true. What's great about verse 8 is it's surrounded by verses 7 and 9. Verses 7 and 9, the Lord is reiterating who needs to come with you. Don't bring fear. Don't bring discouragement. See, people come with their discouragement like, you? You're going to do what? No, God said, don't, no. Don't bring fear. Anyone who's speaking fear over what God has promised you, you don't need to take them with you. Anyone who's discouraging you from accomplishing what God has promised you, you don't need to take them with you. He said, take some strength and take some courage. I love that. Verse 8 is, here's the roadmap to find the success that I have for you, Joshua. But I'm going to surround that with strength and courage. You're going to need some strength. You're going to need some courage to accomplish this. There may be distractions or obstacles that are going to try to keep you from the promises. But God does not change. No matter what tries to keep you from accomplishing what God has set out for you from the beginning of time, God's plan does not change. So don't choose to accept what the naysayer, what the enemy tries to throw at you. Don't accept that, because God does not change. Don't get distracted. Don't let the obstacles seem like too much. There's a Jordan River in front of you, but I'm telling you that the promises are right on the other side. If you look at the water and say, oh, it's too deep. Oh, it's too cold. Oh, there's just too much fish in there. We can't go. Don't let the obstacles keep you from the promise. 2 Corinthians, the first chapter in the 20th verse, it says this. For no matter how many promises God has made, they are yes in Christ. And so through him, the amen is spoken by us to the glory of God. No matter what the promises are, here's the two things you've got to know. When God promised it, you just got to say, yes, I believe. And amen, so let it be. Walk in what he's promised, not in what the naysayers have to say about it. Meditate on his promises and not on what the distractions have to say. These promises were given to Israel long before, but the distractions limited them. See, remember, I talked about Joshua not being young, not being a spring chicken. Joshua was a long lifer. Joshua was going a long life. See, I know this because if you go back in Numbers chapter 13 and 14, God told Moses, I'm giving you this land. Go ahead and send some spies to go check it out. And they sent 12 of them. One of those 12 was a young man named Joshua. And when they came back, they were bewildered by the distractions. They're giants. They're this, they're that. All the naysayers started speaking out. And Caleb, another of the 12, said, no. The Lord said it's ours. We can take it. And then Joshua joined in. He's right. The Lord has promised this to us. It's ours. But the other 10 kept speaking evil against what God had promised. Now, what happens there in chapter 14 is those other 10 drop dead. I'm just saying. Just putting that out there for your thought process. The ones who spoke against God's promise died. And then God gave this message to Moses, that because the people listened to the naysayers, they were not going to walk into the promise. He said, no one who is 20 years old or more will enter into the land, except for Joshua and Caleb. Now, I mention that because clearly God is saying, right, everybody who's over 20, y'all ain't gonna make it. Man, what? That must have been disheartening, right? You're 30 years old. You're like, oh, man. Come on, man. Why I had to be 30? He said, anybody who's 20 years or more is not gonna walk into the promise except Joshua and Caleb. I'm telling you this because that clearly defines for you that Joshua's over 20 years old. So after 40 years of walking around, we know that when God tells him you're going to lead these people, he's at minimum 60 years old. Now, theologians research and do all the math to figure it out. I don't know. I know he's at least 60. Many say he's probably in his 80s. Why am I telling you this? Because to my long lifer, I need you to know that God is not done with you because man has put a number on you. Joshua had every reason to say, pick somebody else. It can't be me. I'm too old for this job. But God said, no. No, I'm not concerned about time because I don't operate in time. I'm the God over time. He has so much in store for you. Awesome and mighty God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. So my message to you today is simple. Simple. God sees us completely from the beginning to the end. Joshua walked across And they went and they walked around the walls of Jericho, and the walls came tumbling down. Why? Because he did not allow fear. He did not allow the distractions. He didn't allow the limitations of time. He didn't say, I'm too old. He didn't say, I can't do this. Instead, he said, I'm going to take strength and I'm going to take courage and I'm going to walk in what God has told me. So don't let the distractions dictate your tomorrow. Our God is not confined or contained or limited by time. When the naysayers and the distractors are telling you that, no, that's a waste of your time. No, there's not enough time for you to accomplish that. Don't listen. Instead, take strength and courage in what God has to say over you. Hebrews 13 and 8 says, he is the same yesterday and today and forever. Same God. So be strong and full of courage because the Lord, your God, is with you wherever you go. Just as he promised Joshua, so is his promise to us today. He'll never leave you. He'll never forsake you. He's with you. Walk in the roadmap of success, keeping his word ever before you. Our God is not limited by time. He's the same time after time after time. From the beginning to the end, our God reigns. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I want to touch and agree right now in the spirit with those of you who have felt you have missed something. You have fallen short on time. For those who feel that time has run out on you being able to accomplish something. Whether the limitation is somebody told you there's not enough time for you to do it, or the limitation is by age. Whatever the time construct is that's limiting you from what God has for you, I want to agree with you right now that the creator and maker of time is not bound, is not limited by man's interpretation of time. God is with you. If that's you, just stretch forth your hand, and I agree with you in the spirit right now. Lord, I thank you that you are awesome, you are mighty, you are great. Your strength is well beyond our strength. Give us the courage to walk in what you have promised, Lord. I pray right now with my brothers and sisters that are listening that, Lord, you would strengthen them right where they are. Lord, that the limitations of time would not hinder them. Lord, that they would walk in your promises, that your promises would be ever before them. That they would look to you, O God. They would seek after you, O God, in knowing that you will do and accomplish all that you have promised. You said you'd never leave us. You said you'd never forsake us. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that it is not too late. That you made a plan for us before the beginning of time. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, God, that you're not bound by time. That time sets no limits on you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, that you spoke time into existence. That you, oh God, reign over time. So God, I pray, Lord, that you would meet every single one of your children right now where they are. And fill us, God. Fill us with strength. Fill us with courage. Help us, oh God, to remain focused on you, knowing that you're a faithful God and you will do just what you've promised. Thank you for it today, God. Touch, move. Thank you, Lord, that right now we feel your presence lifting our hearts out of despair, out of distress. Thank you, Lord. Our hope is found in you, the God who promised to never leave us or forsake us. Thank you that your promises, they're yes and amen. We trust in that word today, God. Thank you for being the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. Thank you, Lord, from the beginning to the end. Your word remains true. Thank you for it, Lord. I pray your blessings over your people as we walk in your word, Lord, as we spend the time that you have blessed us with, honoring you, oh God, worshiping you, oh God. Thank you, Lord. All the glory is due to your name. Bless us where we are, oh God, and help us to walk in the victory that you have for us. We thank you for it, Lord. Your blessings over your people, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen, amen, amen. Awesome and mighty God. I just want to take a moment. And for those who are watching and you don't know this marvelous God, the creator of time, the one who knew you before you ever existed, the one who spoke over you before time ever began. If you don't know him, then I'd love to pray this prayer with you. If you would just repeat after me. Lord, we come. I ask you, Lord, into my heart. Lord, I surrender my life to you. I'm grateful, God, that you hold my life in your hand, that you care for me, and that you've made plans for me. And so I surrender my plans, my thoughts to you, God. Jesus, I ask you to come into my heart. Lead me, guide me. Forgive me of all of my sin and my wrong. Thank you, Lord, that time is not wasted, but instead you redeem the time. Forgive me of all of my sin. And Lord, help me to walk in your victory today and forevermore. Thank you, Lord, for your forgiveness. I surrender it all to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Thank you, church family. I pray that these words would resonate with you, that you would know that the God, over time, has a plan for you. He always has, from the beginning to the end. Before time ever began, he had a plan for you. I pray that you walk in that this week and that you meditate on his word. Be strong and be courageous and walk in all that God has for you. Amen? Amen, amen. Well, church, Live Free Church exists for 5 reasons. We exist to worship God with passionate expression, to share the good news of Jesus with others, to connect with other believers in meaningful relationships, to empower leaders to fulfill their God-given destiny, and to prepare disciples to impact present-day culture. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, God, for the reasons why we exist. Church, I pray God's blessings over you, that you would have an amazing week as you walk in the victory that God has given you. Time after time, he never comes up short on his word. From the beginning to the end, he's yet still the same. I pray that he's with you in Jesus' name. Amen. Be blessed.
We hope you enjoyed today's message and pray that you experience the freedom God has for you through His Son, Jesus Christ. John chapter 8, verse 36 says, "If the Son gives you freedom, you are free." If you would like more information about Live Free Church, please visit us on the web at www.livefreechurch.org.